Somebody need to do a song for L.A.
Straight up.
Just go out to L.A. Oh, new anthem. Look down to live and die in L.A. California.
What you say about Los Angeles?
Still the only place for me.
It never rains in the sun.
To live and die in L.A. Where every day we try to fatten our pockets. Us niggas hustle for the cash, so it's hard to knock it. Everybody got their own thing coming to chase it.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Gang Talk Radio with Sister Herron and Skipp Townsend. I want to give a shout out to Sister Herron. She is not here with us tonight, but I always want to give a shout out to her for her steadfast commitment and having this show and been doing this since June of 2009. So thank you, Sister Herron. And as always, whenever I approach the microphone, I give honor and praise to God. I'm just grateful to be alive. I'm happy to be here this evening with all of you, especially with the distinguished guests I have on the panel this evening. I'm grateful to be here. And also, I want to go back a week. And I was in Atlanta, Georgia last week, and I wasn't able to be on the show. And I miss my mentor, Cecil Murray, Chip Cecil Murray and John Mack. And they joined the show with Sister Herron. And I believe Mr. Woods was here as well. Appreciate that. So I just want to give a shout out to them. I always feel like I owe them money when Cecil Murray and John Mack speak. I feel like I just got educated, like I went to college. So I just want to give a shout out to them and thank you for being here. But tonight we have a distinguished panel as well, and I'm not going to do any introductions. I'm just going to tell you that these are the ones. Ray Charles had a song out, said "The Right One, Baby." It was a jingle for Pepsi or something, but I got the right ones, baby, tonight. So I'm going to allow the individuals to introduce themselves, take a couple minutes, let the community know who you are, and maybe just a little bit about your background. We'll get more in depth later on, but let's start with the gentleman to my right.
Thank you for having me here, too, Skip, and all the guests for all of us being here. And let us pray and hope that we can come to some type of solution and resolution to stop this violence. My name is Melvin Farmer, Prison Ministry Coordinator, River of Life Ministry, Civil Rights Activist, author, the Three Strikes You In book, The New Slave Ship, and I'm a civil rights and social and political activist.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Skip, for allowing me to be here today and be in the presence of these great men here. My name is Pete Winbush, part of River Life Ministries, civil activist, community activist, and a part, like I said, just basically trying to make it, communicate with the gentleman that's here to try to keep lines of communication that's open in these streets.
Yes, sir. Appreciate you, Pete.
I'm Ayatollah Marr from Compton, California. One of the senior members of PIRUs in the city of Compton, California, trying to activate that Black Lives Do Matter with us and with everybody else, and pushing this program so we can come up under one banner.
Yes, sir. So, Marv, you started off by saying senior member of the Compton, California. I just want to say for everybody listening, that means like triple OG, G on top of G. Let me ask you something, Marv. Right now there is a movement in Compton where people are not even calling it Compton anymore. They're saying it's Bompton, and it's the BPT. Tell us a little bit about that, man. Is there a divide in Compton? Is there a separation? Is there a movement to bring it back together? Is it a movement to make one Compton, Compton United? Is it a move to save lives, brother? And if so, speak to that just briefly.
Well, people misconstrue or misinterpret why the city of Compton is called Bompton, why we call it Bompton. Compton, California is the first Black-run city west of the Mississippi's. We've had the first Black mayor, first Black police chief, the first Black city council. It was west of the Mississippi's. We had the only Black institution of higher learning, Compton College, all through the 70s. We have a lot of amazing. We have more athletes in the Olympics, Black, than any other state in the United States. So it's a gang of Black wealth and Black history in the city of Compton. So we call it Bompton, California, even before what we was banging. So that's the consideration, that right now our numbers are dwindling, and it's critical that we understand why we're in Bompton, California.
Yes, sir. So saying that, talking about the levels of higher education in Compton and talking about some of the things that you brothers do with the River of Life Ministries and the work that you're doing, do you believe that people are set out here purposely to destruct movements like your own that you guys have going on to enhance the life and empower people? Do you think that there are people sent out here to actually get in the way and distract what you're doing?
Well,
go ahead, Pete.
I'll go ahead and step up to that one. As you know, Skip, I was a part of the original gang truce in 1992 when my brother Melvin was he was away, and he's going through what he was going through. I'm glad to have him home. Things did happen, and things were going pretty good for a while. You know, in Watts, that was our crib once upon a time too, as well. Because Watts and Compton was like united.
Yeah, sure.
And at some point, men had jobs, young men had jobs, and things were going really good. And then we came under attack, and then certain things happened in the community, and we didn't know who was doing the killing. And so a lot of our senior members are coming home now, and we want to make it like we used to be in the community, not necessarily do anything wrong to anybody, just protect our lives so we can survive. And so we coming together so we can keep the line of communications open in our community,
Yes, sir. The question is, and I appreciate the work you guys are doing. The question is, do you think that there's a distraction there? Because, I know that the two of you are solid members of the community and can really make things happen. So do you think that they're like, what you call them, agent provocateurs that are being placed in to disrupt or disseminate negative information to keep the foolishness going?
I think that's part of it, but the more bigger problem is we have people that are speaking on our problem that's not from the city, and they're exclusive.
Right.
We have to create it where men like you, me, your voice is heard, other people's voices is heard, but when we complain, the ones that are really the victims, don't nobody care about us, like the Keith Versay murder. Don't nobody care about him. So voices aren't being heard that are really doing the work. So one of the main problems is exclusiveness, where they don't include the community, and where people that's been running the same ship, and it's almost nepotism that exists in here. We have black-owned newspapers that are aligned with another organization that create conflicts of interest all the way up in here.
Sir.
So we have to keep it right and keep it 100, because just because the elephant got the biggest head don't mean he has all the sense.
Yes,
now,
sir.
We have to have it to where this man here,
yes, sir,
he's a great man. He has knowledge. And we have to go back to that time to where we start passing down our history, because most people don't even know what they're fighting for
right. In
this situation. They don't. And then it's up to us that were actually there when it started to step forward from behind their shells, because they're the ones who got killed first, like where I'm from. I've been there since the day it started. That's been 40 years.
Right.
So if we can get these men to come together and squash their beef, then anybody behind them, because they had to join something they started, so they ain't running nothing anyway.
Right. Not,
and then if the original members have swashed their beef, that means everybody from everywhere, if every one of them do that, they cannot argue about the actual people who were hurt at the beginning, and they swashing it, everybody need to fall back, or else we cannot help the nation. How are we going to address whites killing blacks and we still killing each other?
Right.
That don't resonate. It don't resonate with you.
Well, you know what? I can, though. I totally get it, because I want to do both. I want to talk to Baby Killer and Tiny Shooter and ask them, do you guys even know what you're killing for? But then at the same time, I do want to address American society for even believing that they can kill Tamir Rice, could kill Ezell Ford, the young man Busby killed over here on Slauson and Crenshaw. How can we accept these things from other people? So what I want to do is I want to address both sides, that I don't believe it should happen either way.
as okay. And you're talking about
come to the mic a little bit, bro.
You're talking about agents. This is a business, and the biggest business is the murder of blacks, and the murder of blacks is through misinformation. Mm. We got to take responsibility because OGs fell off for 20 years. They got on crack. They got on sin. They start acting like they was 10. And the authorities that were getting the payoff, yeah, they you know, they recruiting kids from high school in the police department to infiltrate these neighborhoods. So this is a business. And you have dudes coming from Victorville, from Lancaster. You don't know where their mamas live, and they come in, they study a Piru, but you accept them. They say they're a Crip, and you accept them. And every month, they go and get debriefed.
Right.
And they know everything about you. So this is not something, it's way bigger than us. We just think minutely. This authority has done this all over the world.
Right.
He's established coups and killed people, not one or two, 30, 40,000. So if we kill for the rest of our life, we ain't kill more whites than whites kill whites.
Right.
It's a bad thing. But like you say, today is that we have to start teaching our blacks to show that there's another target instead of themselves.
Right.
I have no problem with what happened in Dallas. I think we should have made barbecue the next day and celebrated a new Nat Turner. That's me.
Yes, sir.
Because something's got to happen.
Right.
And it's not going to happen with politics. We've given our lives for everything in America but ourselves.
Right.
We fought in every battle. We've did everything else. But when it comes to us doing something for us, we pray, we demonstrate, we march. And they kill, and they kill, and they kill. So when are we going to start killing for us?
You had said something, Marvin. I want to come back to this side of the room because of what you said, too, Melvin, when you were talking about the OGs coming together and the youngsters have to fall in suit. And what I found is a mixture of what you said. They're coming from Victorville, Lancaster. They come into your communities, and they're 14, 15-year-olds beating them up and putting them on. And now they're from your hood because a group of 15 or 14-year-olds and put them on, but they're not relevant to the movement. They're not relevant to what happened 40 years ago. They're not relevant, never been to prison. They don't go to the clubs in Hollywood. They don't go and interact with other communities. They're just this small pile of youngsters, but they putting each other on at 14 and 15 years old. And some of them even have to catch the train and go home far away as Victorville, Lancaster, Moreno Valley. How do we stop that? How do we stop the influx of the youngsters that are coming into our communities, getting put on, and then they going back to somewhere else and creating havoc on Facebook and Instagram and Snapchat?
Well, before we move on to that, okay. Yeah, that was a whole lot, Brother Skip.
All right.
But I just wanted to just touch on what the brother was saying, you know, on our kings over here. And basically what he was saying, in other words, we have to basically know that sometimes in the art of war, they try to deceive you by getting you to not fight. And, you know, they're saying, well, when the supreme art of war is to conquer someone without making them fight. I haven't quote in front of you, but it's there. Yeah. And we just want to make sure that they're not trying to get us all calmed down like they've been doing since they did it in the 60s. They did it in 92. They did it in the 9/11. I mean, everybody talking about God when it's appropriate, when they feel like it's they can be go to some city like a refuge, they go to God. But all before that, nobody wants to hear about nothing good and righteous. So we just want to make sure that we're not being duped into something and we, you know, if they're gonna take our lives if we decide just to calm down, are they gonna lock us up in some kind of concentration camp or something like that? Mm-hmm. What's really going on? We want truth, and we want some real dialogue, because they don't want to never admit when they're wrong. So right. We want to find out some truth, you know, and
you know, if you get some truth, I think we can get a lot of things resolved and a whole lot of things, because we're the only allies that America has. Once they lose us, it's going to be destroyed from the inside out.
Right.
And so they want to either make us allies or they make us enemy. We got to find out what they want to do with us.
This is wisdom, brother. This is much, much needed wisdom. Appreciate that. Brother Melvin, was you going to share something real quick?
Well, I was going to just reiterate that when I say, oh, geez, it's up to us to step out. And it ain't like what we say go, because what make OG OG is not the age, not because you first, to me, my opinion. It's when you was born into something to where your parents have never seen. That's what make you OG. Now, what make you a next generation is when it comes to where your parent was born in it and couldn't tell you what not to do and you don't listen. See, we didn't have that when we came out. That's the difference 46 years later. We're trying to tell you, I did 30 years. He did time. All our life, if we tell our story, we can talk about murder till the day we die. We're tired of it. And we're doing something about it. Instead of just talking, we're coming with a plan. We're coming with a solution. We're dialoguing amongst each other. Because one thing about you and the kings I have here, we're connected because we're unscratched. We only stay within the guidelines of what happened in our era. And then when we disappeared during 20, 30 years fighting the Mexican mafia, the ABs, to make it safe for them to go now, because when we first went to prison, we were anti-black. So imagine going against Geronimo Pratt and all these dudes of veterans of war. And this is the respect we get now. And we've seen this. And now an even more bigger problem is now the G's kids are in the same predicament they is where they're targets. So it ain't about where you're from. It's about are you going to take responsibility for your family and your fellow man. Because I ain't doing it for pleasure. I'm doing it because I want my daughter safe. Right. And in the meantime, if it helps your daughter, so be it. Because I don't want to see my daughter killed for something I helped produce.
Right.
That's not right.
Yes, sir. I totally get it. And one of the things that Taco always says is the life you save may be your own. So for me, it's a matter of atonement. And I do it, too, because I have 12 kids. I have 7 boys. And I want all of them to remain living until they're 100 or old enough to see some things. Go ahead. I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, it's okay. You know, I'm getting older now, so I lose my train of thought. I got to take notes. I think I'll bring my notebook back. But basically, I wanted to ask the question to society, basically, you know, we were considered a proud people. And then we came up, when Melvin and I came up, and
Brother Marv.
Yes, sir. Bodacious and putting it all on. I remember back in the day. But when we came up, we didn't have a lot of opportunities, and we had to carve opportunities for ourselves because we were considered so proud they didn't want us.
Right.
And, you know, a lot of youngsters have a lot of opportunities today that we didn't have. And music was a communication that really was still to this day, it was used to either keep something down or fire something up. But I guess what I was trying to ask is that it seemed like we never get any kind of help, because we just dealing with the cards that was dealt to us, and we trying to survive the best way we can. We don't control nothing. We're not oppressive. We're not racist, because we don't control anyone. So we just trying to survive. And so it seemed like until we do something wrong, like the world record used to be by the Whispers.
Yeah, that was a cold
seemed
thing.
Like I got to do wrong before they notice me. You know, we walk in, try to get a job. All the jobs is taken, and you know, most of our people on Skid Row, from the east side and everything, you know, seem like I got to do wrong. When are you going to notice us? And if you, I feel if you notice, if they notice you, Skip, Brother Marv, Brother Melvin, myself, then others will come forward. But if they don't do anything, when we try to come forward, if they don't come to assist the people that's trying to do the right thing, well then, that silence is considered we not accepting it.
So I personally like my people. I love my people. I like being around people older than me that can teach me my history and this and that. And once I get this information from all of you, and as I get it from others, it empowers me. and I come now from a position of strength to the point where when I go into society, I'm arrogant and I'm confident. You know, I'm humble amongst you right here. But when I go in front of other people in other places, other cities, I'm cocky, I'm arrogant and confident because I have got the blessings of my elders and I've listened to the things that have happened and I don't need validation from them. You know who validates me? Who validates me is all of you. When you greet me and I see that you greet me in love, you greet me in peace. That's my validation that I'm worthy of something as opposed to the person who won't give me a job. Well, then I will create one. The person who won't give me a place to stay, then I'll go sleep in my ex-wife's garage. You know, the person who won't give me a car loan, then I know how to go to the auction and put together a bucket and make it look like it's the best thing ever. I mean, and these are things that we've learned. I don't want to say we, but these are things that the black people have had to learn in order to survive. We've had to learn how to make it work. And I got a carpenter over here, electrician and auto mechanic, and we work together at building our community. Go ahead, Brother Moore.
And like brothers is explaining, we started this without a blueprint. Right. We had to work this ad hocly. And we had to respect. When I was in prison, it wasn't anything I could say to Death Row Jeff. Wasn't nothing I could say to Buford Beard. Wasn't nothing I could say that didn't make sense to Doc Holliday. Or I would get straight checked right then. Where'd you get it from? What book you get this from? Did you get it from the Red Book? What did you get it from this? And this, so I had to earn my rights first mentally. Then I had to produce physically. Where the difference is now, these kids think they have it through inheritance. Mm. Just because I live here. You ain't put no work in. You ain't went to jail for a traffic ticket. How are you a gangbanger and went from the first grade to the 12th grade, never had a fight? What kind of dude is you?
Worse than that.
You know what I'm saying?
They took a graduation picture and they ain't never took a mug shot, but they going to take jail.
And it don't make me no, make you know, to have a cap and gown, I would applaud that. But don't think you're critical to this situation when you haven't put anything into the situation.
Right.
Just because I'm here. So now, like I said, I accept responsibility for thinking it was 1999 and I parted and let it go. Right. And now when I come back, he ain't trying to hear me.
Right.
But I'm one of the few that ain't scared yet. Because I still put hands on a 13-year-old. Because I do believe in God. You can't get me unless he say so.
Right.
And whatever you get, I done already done anyway. So you the one got to deal with the challenge. But my point is, we're dealing with youngsters that claim inheritance. No hard work, and they don't want to deal with no hard work. So they're not trying to listen to you how we came up.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I can't tell. I run them out the park all the time. Brothers my age that's telling them. And half of them dudes, they wasn't even cool till they was 30.
Right.
But how are you going to tell a youngster how to put in work and you 50 riding a bicycle, sleeping in the park, you done lost your mama house? So you got no good counsel.
Right.
You understand me? Not that you can show them how not to be a bum.
Right.
But don't go. We got all of these dudes that are saying things that they wasn't even a part of.
Right.
Because now all of us dead, I can say, oh, yeah, I was with Tookie and I did this and I was with, how you know?
Right.
And you 12.
Right. So here's the thing, Marvin, I'm glad you bring that up because back in the days there was a fear. And I'm going to speak for my age group. I'm younger than you guys, but I'm old. I'm 52. So for my age group, there was a fear of walking down certain streets because the leaders of the communities was big and buff dudes. I'm going to say a few names. Barefoot Pookie. You don't want to walk down 108th and Western and run across Barefoot Pookie. You don't want to go to St. Andrew's Park and run across Tookie. You say you got arms and legs this big. You know, you don't want to walk down Central and put and one of them dudes get you, you know. So with that fear came a sense of learning where I had to go and how humbly I had to go in these communities, right? And I want to say that this was the influence. You know, where I come from is a dude named Crazy B, a big buff dude, right? And my homeboy Eddie Chapman. And I want to say that there was a humble experience But however, somewhere in the early 80s, when the crack came in, you know what happened? When the skinny dude, the dude like myself with long hair and skinny, got a sack that big, now I'm the influence. I got guns and I got money. And now I'm not afraid of the big giant dude who has that size now. Now I'm the one that got the dudes listening to me. So I had asked a question earlier about the agent provocateurs. I believe, and I know Sister Herron does too, and she's not here today, but that the crack that came into the system, the money that came into our communities, the guns that came into our communities, it actually separated us on blocks. Let me give you an example. I'm going to give you an example of the community I come from, the West Adams area. That was it. It was just the whole from Alameda to Crenshaw was Blood Alley. It was just one community. And then it separated. And it became the City Stones in the 20s. Then the 20s became the Avenues and the 7 Block, the 9 and the 5, and everybody has their own. You know, 8 Trays got North Side and West Side, and, you know, even the Piru separated Elm Street, Cedar Block, Fruit Town, Mob, Looters. And we started separating behind influence. Who has the greater influence to where now we're separating and trying to bring it back together? I believe that it was by design, exactly what you said, that society has been doing throughout not just our city, but throughout the country, finding ways to separate us to where now we depending on you guys to bring it back together. It's up to y'all to bring it back together.
Well, I'd like to speak on that because you make a valid point. You know, back in the day, you know, when a lot of the brothers was going to jail, they patrolled our community when we were junior high school children. And to us, we didn't realize until we got older when you couldn't get a job because you had a felony, that they was really monitoring us really closely so to give us cases when we were in our crucial informative years, learning life. They didn't do other communities like that, but they made sure we had a record. So by the time we got to a certain age, we already had a fail on our record. So we couldn't really make any advances in our life, and that's that same thing is really sort of going on right now to this day, and you know, I just like I said, I'm getting older now, I'm losing my train of thought, I got to bring my notebook, but you know, when things first started in the beginning, you know, it was we were surviving, we did some things, we robbed, we did different things, but we brought all that money back into the community to help feed her mamas, and your mama, your grandmama was my grandmama, your mama was my mama, and we celebrated. It was about a party. We was all together once upon a time. You know, the power rules, we were always together. You know, if anybody really know the facts, if we sitting at this table, no. But the point is that at some point, it was without agent provocateurs came through our community doing things to us. When the heads went away, the body fell, and they took the heads away. Big Raymond took. I mean, a lot of things happened around the same time. It wasn't no coincidence that these things happened. Took Melvin. A lot of things was going on, and so those things happened. So the lines of communication was broken, so we couldn't make a phone call. And somebody come in our community to do something to us, we couldn't make a phone call. Say, man, did one of the youngsters come over here to do something? What's going on, man? Oh, no, you know, we couldn't make that phone call. We couldn't make them a phone call and get together and party, have a good time, you know. And but the main thing I really think is when, and you should know, you know a lot about this, when the angel dust came into our community.
Right.
That's the first sign to me, because I started this journey in 68, but I didn't start on the west side until 71. But when Angel Dust hit the scene, and it was a business thing, because it was sold and it was used. And that's how I think they got us, too, because they know that a lot of us got high of our own supply.
I'm going to do this real quick. I'm going to be the notebook, and I'm going to remember that we slowed down at Angel Dust, getting high on our own supply. But we got to do right now is take a break. Stevie Wonder's going to set us free for about 2-3 minutes, and we'll be back.
Sir.
To be sure of
All right, you guys. So we're back here, Gang Talk Radio, with Skipp Herron, Sister Herron, and Skipp Townsend. Sister Herron isn't here this evening, and we just want to thank her once again. So I'm here with a very intelligent group of, I want to say young men, but they older than me. So these are the old guys, and they got knowledge and wisdom, and even during the break, it just kept going. I don't want to cut you off, Peak. You were in the middle of Angel Dust, and if there was something you want to continue on here, let me get that for you, bro. Yeah, so if you want to continue with what you're saying, just go right into the microphone, and even though you can't hear, I'll get it for you.
Go on.
Okay, yeah. Like I said, Angel Dust came into our community by way of people that we trusted, you know, because it was ways of making money. And so we were just dealing with the hand that was dealt to us. I keep going back to that because we had to understand that we didn't really have too much. And because we were considered so too proud that when Took and Jamel went on the Gong Show, they were reaching out, you know, because we were just basically being ignored. And also in Art of War, it says something about the strong, you avoid the strong. So I guess maybe they considered us strong, they wanted to avoid us. Opportunities that the youngsters have today just wasn't there for us.
Right.
We just didn't have them.
Right.
And at some point, that situation with the rap game, that was by happenstance. That was with the Suge and Death Row and all that kind of stuff. That was something
Michael
that—
Michael Conception.
Right.
One of the founders of We All in the Same Game.
Right.
And actually, he's participating with us. And I think he's going to get John Legend and a couple more artists for me, which he said I could announce on the radio. So I just put that out there. So we're going on, like I say, I play on a national level, but we got to start on a local level. And I think, one, we have to attack now because this is the time. We can't sit around and debate and all this and that because we come from an era to where one murder could set this off to where it couldn't,
right.
It's over with. The
yes,
wrong
indeed.
Person get hurt. So I'd like the public to know the urgency in this and the seriousness of this because it's never been tried before to where everybody is trying to come up under one accord. And it probably never won't happen again in a near future.
Right. It takes about 20 years, every 20 years when we do this. So I appreciate it. And thank you for saying Mike Conception's name. And for those who don't know, I just got to give him a shout out because he is one of the guys who comes from the community. As a matter of fact, he is the one who started the 107 Hoovers, if I'm not mistaken. So he was a part of the Negative Lifestyle. But he also, I know he managed New Edition and what's the other guy's name? The singer, TQ. You know, so he's done a number of things to help
Rome,
people in the community.
Silky
Rome,
Fine,
right? So
Love the Law,
right?
Love.
So he's done a lot to empower the people in the community. So whenever we have people like that, we gotta shout him out, and he's done it all from a wheelchair as well, you know.
Yes.
So appreciate him and his life. But Marv, offline you said something, brother. I want to come back to it because you were talking about when we saying Angel Dust and we was talking about Juvenile Hall. You were talking about Juvenile Hall back in, what, 71? Or what? When did you do Juvenile Hall? Was that 50-something?
50-something.
Come on. So tell us about it. Yes, I joke. Marv's real old. But Marv, for real, what you were saying about how they were using us and treating us, yeah. And they were experimenting with us, even to the point when you were in Juvenile Hall, brother, and that whole—
They stopped. You know, the saga continues.
To the mic.
And we were discussing about the preview of taking Angel Dust and how the activation period came and how they de-escalated it through the form of crack cocaine. And we were talking about whoever in the policy of prison, juvenile hall, whoever controls the prison controls the ghetto. And their experimentations in prison and juvenile hall, they'll take certain toys and give them to blacks and see how you manage that, and they know what they can do on the street. So they monitor your behavior, and when they monitor your behavior, they're able to accent what a child in your position who's a lesser mind they can do to control it. So it's psychological controlling. So this is what they do in juvenile halls. They do it in in prison. I was explaining to Skip them in 1973. They said Compton was murder capital of the world, and they had 20 killings. San Quentin, we had 189 stabbings and 12 killings in a year. And it was all right, long as blacks was killing Mexicans and Mexicans was killing whites. But they started a moratorium, and they started killing police. When they start killing police, the Valencias, the Verdugos kill three police in Chino. When they end up killing a police in Tehachapi, they shut the whole prison down for 9 months. Went to every cell, took everything out of your cell. And just like a woman have a baby, in 9 months they open the prisons up. But before, you could only have one package a year, 20 pounds. You had to wear all blue, none of your own clothes, and everybody was a convict. In 1974, May 10th, they opened the prison up. And they said you can have a package every month. Okay. And you can wear a T-shirt, and you can have your own shoes. Now it became not a conglomeration of convicts. We became inmates, and we all became individually, because you ain't got tennis shoes, and you ain't got a package. We ain't the same no more, huh?
Ah, okay, I see that. So another way to divide and separate.
So this is what
make me target another brother who may be weaker.
Right.
I'm gonna get his shoes. I'm gonna get his package.
And then, this is how, and we started on the street, like you said before. When you were talking about you were a Bigfoot Pookie, James Miller, these dudes that I remember, Honcho. He catch one of my little homeboys at the swap meet with their red belts on, and he take the belt off and whoop them and give me their belt, man. Tell him he can't be coming, you know, on Long Beach Boulevard like that. So it was that kind of respect.
Right.
But now once this drug thing came along, we start transferring the title of respect. Now it's not respect for your dignity, who got the biggest sack, but who's giving you the sack.
Right.
And they say money and fools soon part. All the money we had from the 70s, the 60s, and the 80s, we ain't got now.
Right.
So it was always a plan. And he's way ahead of us on this plan. And until we, as a whole, as seniors, and we just can't do it with lip service. Because it says, like brother's talking about the art of war, Miles says for every great thing there's a supreme sacrifice. And if you're not willing to give your life, you cannot save a life.
Teach. Right.
This ain't politics. We're not on Capitol Hill. This is the jungle. It ain't but two things in the jungle, predator and prey. So you have to pick what you're going to be.
Oh, I ain't going to be the prey, bro. I can't do that. But, man, you done said some very powerful things, man. And another shout out to Honcho, whose mom actually been on this show. We had Betty Day on this show. And let me tell you that I had a small amount of fear for Honcho, because I would tell him all the time, boy, put your hands on me and I'm going to tell your mama. I'm going to call your mama. I'm going to tell her what you out here doing. So I never had that issue. But let me say to you, brothers, talking about solutions, you know, we got like 20 minutes to finish on solutions, and there was a note just passed to me. Let me share with my thought. I don't know if you guys remember the movie with the little boy talking to Bruce Willis when he said, "I see dead people." Y'all remember that? Mm-hmm. Little boy said it to Bruce Willis, right? And everybody remembers that he said that, but the thing he said after that was so crucial and so important is he said, "And some of them don't even know they dead." He said he see dead people, and some of them don't know they dead. So in the community, what I see as well is I see a lot of dead people. They're spiritually dead. They're mentally dead. They're emotionally dead. They are just in the body, and they don't know that they're disconnected from loving life. And there was an officer this weekend who told me, and I was in Georgia, and he told me that his officers are scared. He said, "Skip, they'll never tell you they scared, but they scared. And what they scared of is dead people. They believe that we're dead. And they will judge one interaction that they have with one person, and they'll give us all that same thing, all that same blanket. Like, well, I fear them, and I'd be ready to shoot them as opposed to getting to know who we are, building relationships, or as it was back in the Andy Griffith days, actually walking a beat and understanding and having some sort of knowledge of the community they serve. So my question to you guys now, do we tell our children, do we get our nieces and nephews to become police officers? Do we tell them that now is the time that we need them to be in public service for us because we need more black officers? We need people who understand the community. Or do we just allow our people to be disconnected?
I think we need blacks, but I think we need to follow how the law enforcement are doing it now, because we're basically up under martial law, because I've been at numerous murder scenes, and only time I see a black officer is he's the one investigating the murder or comment. But what they do is they send – now we're getting military-type younger men – that are signing up in the police from down south, coming with that southern mentality. Just like when you was in prison and they brought women into prison, they weren't used to seeing black men. So they just was fascinated by it. Now, when you come to putting a black in the community to service that community, that creates a conflict of interest in the court. Because let's say, for instance, he grew up with me and he said, oh, I ain't got to chase him. That's Melvin. But then he got to come to court. See, that's a conflict. So that creates it, and it puts too much pressure on somebody to come in their area and then police it. That's very hard for a black. So we need both black law enforcement, but you might need to flip them, say, from San Bernardino and make them come work in a county to where there's no bias and they don't have no fear. Because just like when things happen and people say, well, why do blacks never tell on each other or nothing? Because you sit and put them right back in the same area by the murderer. And then you expect them to tell. So I think we need more black diversity, but it will create a conflict when it comes to evidence and speaking and testimony, because it'll make it to where things doesn't have to be done because, oh, I know him, or that's him, or they family there.
All right.
I just want to say something real quick. We used to police our own community, but at some point. But the thing about it is that it's not so much as black police officers are being on the force and all this kind of stuff, or any kind of position of authority, because evidently we don't have the authority, and there's a lot of Caucasian people, or white people, or whatever you want. Personally, I it's so much confusing with religion and everything. I see why they got so much atheism and all, because it's too much confusion. But pointed, personally, I have certain my own beliefs about people. We all part of this, on this blue planet, and we all part of human beings. But the point is just that the people in authority are not doing anything. They're in positions, but they're not changing nothing. The ones that so-called care about us, or say they care about us, they don't have the power to change anything. I'm speaking of Caucasians, so-called. So-called, it's white people, so-called, because white means purity. So I'm trying to figure out who is really white. If you pure, who got the pure spirit? Who got the purest spirit? Because white means purity. So maybe we all might be black. You know what I'm saying? And I'm trying to figure, but I'm just saying is that if they got some kind, when I spoke before, and I was allowed to speak on behalf with Senator Watson, and it comes to a point where we coming back to our source. We had power, we had God's power, but we didn't talk about it. We knew we all come out of church and different things. That's why we had earrings with crosses on and things like that. But we going back to the source. The source is of all power is God. Some people don't believe in a supreme being, a grand architect, but that's your. I understand it because it's confusion. I understand why police are scared. They have a right to be scared right about now. Because we come from a generation where we saw the killing, saw the Ku Klux Klan on the getting in the police force. We saw that as children. Because I'm from Louisiana, so I saw a lot of things as a child. So, yeah, they have a right to be scared right about now. But if they deal with the people that's trying to come forward and help and really take them seriously, we're not walking dead. We're not, you know, we are spiritual people. We like. Friends, we like to party, we have a good time, we like to eat, we like to do everything everybody else like to do. And we're not as bad as people think we are, but we have a stigmatism that's over us and our communities, because we named one community Hoover, we named community 60s, we named one community. That's our titles of our area, okay? Paru Street, that's the title of our area, man. And so it's just like you put titles on, we put titles on. But I mean, but for to demonize us and say like we just less than human beings,
That's not the way to go.
Well, I say they don't have a right. I don't think they have a right. Police don't have a right to be for fear of us. The other day on Channel 11 News, they had Monique and this brother named Tone X. And the white man asked Tone, he says, well, being the devil's advocate, just think if you were a white police and you worked in a neighborhood where high crime rate and drugs was. Brother tell him, he say, okay, let's look at it and turn it the other way. Suppose I was a white police with a gang of meth heads and I was in a trailer park. Why would it be different? If you're scared of this job, you shouldn't have took it.
Teach.
Didn't nobody just make you do this. You did this sincerely. So you had an underhanded agenda when you came here. Going back to Compton was a black police force. And Huey Taylor, Eric Paradin, all of them grew up in our neighborhoods.
Reggie too, right?
Reggie Wright. Wow. You know, I do something, Marvin, I'm going to tell your mama. Right. I'm going to tell your mama. Now, we had a good police force for years. And then it wasn't from something from outside. Compton police corrupted they self. Start believing they was gang members. So just being a black police don't make it right. I remember one time I was in San Quentin and this brother, Bobby Scott, he was one of the first blacks to be on the goon squad. He's out of Compton, grew up with him, a little younger than me, right? So they came to get me out the hole and he came to my cell. Say, Mar, they thought that I should come and get you, you know. What made you think that? Why you think I'm going to treat you any different than I treat that cracker? Because you didn't come to get me to send me home. You're going to put me in the hole and we cool?
Yes.
So just being black don't make it certified that you're going to be my ally. Because it's black people on. They said, well, all police ain't bad. Well, you just as bad. If you know a police did a killing and you don't say nothing, you're as guilty as them. Because they tell us guilt by association, right? Conspiracy, right? That's their law. So why doesn't it apply to them? So I believe we have to have a firm understanding of what we do with our police in our communities. The only thing that's one of the things I like about the sheriff in Compton. A patrolman can only be in our neighborhood for 18 months. And he got a transfer. So you ain't got the same dude year after year after year.
Right.
So they got a rotation. And it's fair. You know what I'm saying? To me.
Is it fair, or is it that they come in, like you said, with that underhanded mentality anyway, that let's go kick some butt. Let's go, oh, I'm going to Compton. I'm going to get me a couple of them before I leave in my 18 months. So there's a new... So in 18 months, an individual might come in with that mentality, like I'm coming to kick some butt. And after a while, after pulling over the same person, see that this individual is working. This is really a father. This is really a community. And now after a year, they feel a part of it. There's a rookie waiting for his 18 months to come in and chase somebody and hit somebody in the head.
Interestingly, you said that. In 2008. I got arrested 15 times, got pulled over 15 times, and I never knew what was going on, right? And one day, this Mexican sheriff, he pulled me over, and he tell me, I'm going to show you what I'm made of, and tried to pull me out the car and gave me assault, right? And I was on policemap.com, and this dude named Valeris at what really happened in the gang troops. And my name is all in. I didn't know nothing about this book. But it got me all up in here claiming some things that really never even happened. But all the police know about it. But this dude harassed me and they put a file on him. In 18 months, he was gone. He was out of there. And then he had to go back to the jail. They took him out because if they get, one thing about the sheriff, if a police gets three complaints, It may look like when he come up missing, he going back to the jail. It sound good.
But that's horrible, man. All the time I spent in jail and these dudes come in there bitter and angry. So let me tell you, if you a bad hamburger flipper at McDonald's, you're going to be a bad bus driver.
Yeah.
If you're a bad bus driver, you're going to be a bad sheriff deputy. You're going to be a bad police officer.
Yes,
you're going to be a bad father. You're going to be a bad member of the community. How do we make the police department, law enforcement better? I believe is I have a 10-year-old and an 8-year-old son. I believe that I teach them how to run, jump, flip, swim in water, and tell them to get involved, whether it's in the police department or the fire department, the sheriff department, but they have to get involved in somehow giving back to the community. And one argument I had, I got to say Sergeant Whittle's name on camera, had an argument with him about 5-6 years ago, and he said, Skip, whatever, I never missed a paycheck. He said, my check has been there the whole time. You know, the whole time you was in prison, Skip, back and forth to jail, all that. He said, I got a raise, everything, you know. Mm-hmm. And so, and he's black. So I appreciate him hitting me in the head with the fact that he's well-to-do right now. As I struggle with French fries and faucet water, you know, he's eating nice.
At what cost?
At what cost for me, too?
Yeah.
At what cost for him? And at what cost for me? So do I teach my children to get involved to that level? Or do I stand my ground and say, nah, man, my kid's not going to be the police, F the police? I mean, you know.
I can only say this. I got a 3-year-old and I got a 5-year-old. Right. I got a 14-year-old.
And people talking about you, too, being over 60 with them two. And go ahead, though. Go ahead. Having all them young kids. Go.
They talking.
I thought when he said 2 and 3, I thought he meant 23.
So, I'm going to teach my kids how to shoot. Everybody don't want it here. But white people teach. They on the range at 7 and 8.
Yes, they are.
With black targets. So until they're prepared, I don't want my kid to get in the police force and not be prepared. I don't want my child to do nothing without being prepared. And I want them to be mentally and socially prepared. But I don't want them to be deficient. A sister put up on a poster, we have to tell our kids to, when they see the police, to hold their hands up and cross their legs. They still getting killed. Shoot those and shoot you.
All right.
I just want to say too, you know, it just goes to show that, you know, mental illness is not prejudice. I mean, it's not with the word to use. It attack anyone because it's a lot of mental illness in that police department.
And it has no boundaries.
It has no boundaries. Yes, sir. Thank you. And so, you know, it's mental illness in our communities because they begin pumping us with these drugs and different things. But so, you know. It's a lot of things going on that's just not quite right. Life is not perfect. But however, if we say we're dealing with the hand that was dealt to us, I feel like if they really sincerely work with people like us, and sincerely, I'm talking about sincerely, not just to get us dummy down so they can come and round us all up and put us away. Because that's what they're talking about. They've been talking about it. We've been listening. We have been listening to what they're saying. Alex Jones is we're not dead. They might talk about like we zombies or whatever, because they talk about that New Orleans. That's the first time I heard it used the word zombies in the 20th century, and they called the people in New Orleans zombies. A lot of people don't know that. They shut it out down real quick. But I really believe they help people like Melvin, Marvin, yourself, and me, and others. That if once they do that, others will come forward because they say, well. Most people don't want to come forward because they say, we tried being nice. It's not working.
Right.
It's not working. So forget it. It's nothing else to do.
Right. So I agree with Marv, predator and prey mentality. And I agree with something that you had said as well when you were talking, Peek, about the art of war. The strategy is to convince my opponent not to even fight. So for me, I want to use the strategies that's used against me. I want to convince law enforcement to not even fight, to not fight my community. And I think that I can catch more flies with a little bit of barbecue sauce and sugar in it than I can with a pile of poop over here in one corner. So, I'm going to take that to heart. So, listen, you guys, we got about 5 minutes left, and there's so much wisdom going on at this table. If each of you could take like 2 minutes and close out and let the community know. I'll start wherever. Y'all tell me where to start. I'm starting over here with you, Brother Melvin. Okay, so I'm going to start with you, Marv. Marv ain't got no problem talking.
No, none at all.
So but, go ahead, Brother Marv, representing Compton, California. I appreciate you being here. What you want to leave the...
I just want to leave with the old additive and the note that's always been progressive, each one teach one. And then we have to go back to that and go to our respective tribes and learn how to deal with each other. They say the greatest victory, as you implored, is winning a war with no bloodshed.
Right.
So once we can determine how we can win this war with us,
right,
without any bloodshed, we can conquer the world.
Yes, sir. And I want to give a shout out to Cynthia Nunn and Sylvia Nunn's Angels out there in Compton doing incredible work, and they're working with the young people. And well, they work with everybody, but right now during the summer months, they're working with the young people. And just want to give a shout out because I know that they work hard, and I want to say they're underfunded, but that would be lying. They don't get no money at all.
And y'all support old Cynthia. I've been knowing Cynthia since I was 19 years old. Her mama, her daddy, with me, China Dog, Jeff, and all them was from Compton. And we grew up in YA, Nellis together. And that's the thing about us from back in them days. China Dog, Puddin' Tam, Bodacious, James Miller, Russell Capers, it don't matter because we all was together. But we stood up in there where whatever we did back then, we respected what happened then, but we didn't go hold no grudges. Right. We let it go because that was what was then. But it was fair. It was what it was. It went through that era, but we've always had respect. We didn't go because when the Bloods came out, it was so many Crips, you had to be tough to be a Blood.
Yes,
and I'm going to give them that.
Right.
Because we were united. So for every one Blood, it might be 50 of us.
Right.
But never during the prison system or the juvenile system, particularly the juveniles, because there wasn't too many Bloods and Crips going in your era because everything was pro-black.
Right.
So when I got to the black, it was anti-black. But the real question to where we can eliminate all this, it ain't coming down to but one thing. Either you pro-black or you anti-black.
Right.
And you got to make a choice. It ain't no discussion about, oh, I'm from Piru, I'm from this. No, the real question is, are you black, are right, you pro, or you anti?
I'm going to use that and put it on Facebook tonight. Peek, you want to leave the community with something?
Well, no, I just wanted to just thank you for being here, man, and being amongst these great men like yourself and Brother Mel, Brother Mark. But I just want to say, you know, shout out to Mike Conception, too, because
our boy, man.
Thank you for correcting me about that, because I was just on a run. But, yeah, Mike, he's always been there for us, man, and, in our time of, you know, he's been there, man.
And right.
He's a good brother, man, really, really a good brother, good king. Right. And so I want to send a shout out to him. But that's one thank you for being here, man, giving us the time to share with the world what's going on out here.
Yes, sir. Truly appreciate it. So in closing for me, I want to say that we have the ability to harm or to heal. We have the ability to reason using logic and not emotion. So what I want to do leaving here tonight is not be emotional, not get into conflict with my brother, but figure out a way to be logical and reasonable and deal with it. And also, I want everybody to keep their head to the sky, because that's the reason why.
Hey, and also we want to give a shout out to Big U and my pastor, Reverend Rodney Bugner and River of Life Ministry, because without them, what is going on couldn't even possibly exist on our side. So we want to give a shout out to all those, Tony Stacy, Barefoot Pookie, T. Rogers that called me, all my crew, Guy Walker from Compton, and all them, Drek from East Coast.
Appuccino.
We run out of time. No, appreciate all y'all. Everybody, keep your head to the sky.